please stand. We open with our family name. We open in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, God loves you. Let us draw near with a true heart, confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Give us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated as we sing Come to Calvary's Holy Mountain, verses 1 through 4. This time we invite our children to come forward for our children's message. You see, children are gifts to us, huh? Yeah. You know, we're going to touch on this in the sermon. We're finally all God's children, right? And so we're looking at Transfiguration. Is it Transfiguration Sunday? No, but we're doing the Mark thing. And so we find Transfiguration in the Gospel of Mark today. So that's what we're doing in the chapter 9. I brought a light bulb and I brought a Bible for the kids. Light bulb, Jesus shone like the sun. You couldn't look at him, right? Reminds you of Moses when he came down the mountain, but a great one greater than Moses, right? And that's Jesus. But somebody else was there, Moses and Elijah. And what that signifies is that as all the Old Testament, Moses wrote the first five books, Elijah is the chief prophet, right, together with Isaiah and so forth, but Elijah represents them all. They all come together in Jesus. The whole book, it comes together in Jesus. He is the revelation of God for us. Our Savior, our Lord, the one who fulfills everything, God's love for us and the life that he would have us live. That's like a light bulb coming on, huh? And it's a light to live in. And that's the children's sermon for all God's children, and all God's children say, amen. Continue with beautiful Savior. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, it's daylight savings time. How are you guys feeling with that? You know, why don't we greet one another in the love that we know in Jesus and wake up and move a little bit, huh? And you guys at home, high five, get another cup of coffee, whatever you got to do, all right? Let's just wake up by loving on each other real quick here, huh? Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Morning. ID. Good morning. Wasn't that fun stuff? You know, we missed it, didn't we? It's a gift that God gives us again. We can actually touch each other. Amen. And I hope you guys at home got that cup of coffee and are ready to go too. I'm Brad. I'm one of the pastors here. I'm the funny guy, I guess. I don't know, but I'm one of the pastors here. And we get to talk about Jesus today. And we pray that His Spirit, through these words that Jesus gives us, will touch your heart and mine, and give us His gifts. So. That our focus, we're going through the book of Mark, looking at chapter 9 today. Hopefully you had a chance to read that before you came. There's some excerpts in the little folder we gave you. Asking yourself those questions, what is God the Holy Spirit teaching me here, and what am I going to do about it, right? And so I hope you had a chance to do that. We're going to look at it a little more today, and then we have a study that we're going to put out so that you can do that in small groups or in your families or even alone to look even more at these words of Jesus to us. Life with Jesus, today the theme is light, and see that word questions? I should have put those in capitals and like bold capitals, because really this is about questions. That's what it's about. But it's surrounded by light or power, faith or trust and peace, okay, the shalom peace of God. But it's about those questions that we, I don't know about you, but I got questions, huh? I seem to always have, and I don't know about you, but that's what it's about. It's about the idea of life with Jesus, following with Jesus in the midst of those questions. That's what this chapter is about. Chapter 8, it was all about the confession. Jesus said, "Who do you say I am? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God," right? And Jesus says, "Okay, I'm gonna be rejected by the chief priests. I'm gonna die on the cross. I'll rise again." But it was kind of like, "And I'll rise again. You know, I'm gonna suffer and die and be rejected." And Peter said, "What you talking about, man? We don't want to go through that stuff." And Jesus said, No, Peter, get behind me, Satan." Then he says, "Hey, if you want to follow me, take up your cross." See, it was all about the cross. It's all about suffering. And yet, towards the end of that chapter, there's a little page turning. Jesus points to his coming and all of his glory. But even then, that chapter leaves them walking under the cross, under the suffering. Chapter 9 is, he turns the page. It starts with this: "I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with," read that word, "power." All of a sudden, it's about power. And it's about them seeing it. Seeing this power. They're going to live under the cross, but Jesus wants them to know and see and live in his power. And he's going to reveal it to them and to us because it's written down for us, right? These words weren't written down for the guys that went through it. They already knew it. Now, they already had learned what they were supposed to learn. They were written down for us so we could go through these same things as the disciples. So what happens? A few days later, 6 days later, he was transfigured before them. And I tried to come up with a different picture. Have you ever been out on the water and the sun is so bright, you're almost going like this? I don't know if you've ever been in the water that way. And it's so brilliant. I mean, there's lots of ways to describe the brilliance of Jesus that day, right? Looking into the sun, okay, but you look away all the time, right? And you can't, and you think about a light bulb and it's like this. But I remembered being in the water and like, bang, and you can't, the sun's going down and it's reflecting off the water and you can't look at it, and it envelops you. That's what was happening with Jesus. Now imagine that. Jesus had just been a regular guy in a sense, right? Isaiah says he was nothing to look at. And all of us, and now he was talking about the cross and suffering, and if you want to follow me, you got to take up your cross. And now all of a sudden, he takes Peter, James, and John to the top of the mountain, and he's shining like the sun. Do you see the page turning here? It's talking about how we do life with Jesus, certainly under the cross, but in his power, in his glory, in his light. Peter said, "Rabbi, it's good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters." You know, Peter takes it, he takes it on the jaw for this sometimes. Even in the text, he didn't know what he was talking about, right? But as I thought about this, I think Peter got something right here. You know, Jesus said, "You're going to see the kingdom of God come with power," then he's transfigured before them. A good Jew would have said, "Well, when are we going to kick the Romans out of here, man? Let's go to war, Jesus. Let's do it." But Peter didn't go there. You know, this was so ingrained in them. We see in Acts 1, just before Pentecost, the disciples want to talk about the kingdom, and Jesus doesn't talk about the kingdom like they want because they want to kick out the Romans. But here, Peter is so overwhelmed by the glory of Christ being in his presence, And he says, you know, I just want to stay here. I just want to be with you. And this word for shelter, it doesn't simply mean tent or tabernacle. It harkens back to the tabernacle in the Old Testament, where God dwelled with his people, where he filled the tabernacle with his Shekinah, with his glory. And Peter's saying, I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. You know, we did this Red Letter Challenge thing, and actually Nathan's going through it again with those who want to on Wednesday nights. And the very first thing is being. Being. That's where Peter was at. Jesus said, remain in me. Be in me. You don't need anything else. It's just about doing life in me. See, that's what Peter got. Do you get that? Jesus really and truly is the only solution for the emptiness that we all struggle with. The gnawing feeling that there has to be more than this. The specter of death at the end of the rainbow. The shadow of eternity that every human being knows is there. I don't care if who you are and where you come from, and all of humankind is looking to fill that hole in their heart. And you don't get there by climbing a mountain. You don't get there by swimming an ocean. And we see this in our lives. We long for relationship, but we always short-circuit it. And we circle the wagons and we try to live life alone. Peter got it right. He saw in Jesus the one that would fill him up. And he says, that's where I want to be. I want a tabernacle here. I want to be in his presence. Right now, the Spirit of God is talking to your heart and mind. Maybe for the first time, or maybe you haven't thought about it in a long time. Maybe you've wandered far away from the idea of God in your life and God in your world. But Jesus is about this gracious invitation, this grace and love that has no strings attached, that would fill us again and would empower us to be like Peter. I just want to be here. A place that no matter what we're about, we never should leave. Peter got it, at least in that way. He missed it in another way, but he got it that way. The voice of the Father had him straighten out and said this. He said, go ahead, put the next one up for me. The voice, this is my beloved Son, whom I love. Listen to him. So the Father, notice the Father wasn't jamming Peter. Peter kind of had it right, I think. But he was saying, hey, Peter, you don't have to circle the wagons. You don't just say right here. You do life in the presence of my Son. You do life tabernacled with him. He makes his tabernacle within you. He makes his dwelling within you, you see? And so you can walk the path of following Jesus because you're doing it in the reality that Peter longed for, that each of us longs for. The reality of living connected in the presence of Jesus. It's not a place of inaction. It's a place of action in him, following him, living in his presence, remaining in him. Peter, you got the first part right. You just don't understand the power of my Son, the incarnation that he became one of you. so that you might do life in him. You see, take up your cross and follow Jesus. Where's the power to do that? He tabernacles with you. He makes his home within you. You are his own dear child as you trust in him and receive him into your very selves by faith. Wonderful place. But the thing that strikes me about this whole chapter, and really all of Mark, there's always questions. Even in this transfiguration, the glory of God revealed, all the questions answered, right? I don't know. Go ahead, put that up. Moses and Elijah were there. Why? Now we can postulate, right? And many theologians have, well, it represents all of the Old Testament. Moses was the lawgiver. Elijah was the one who would restore all things. And now you put them all together, and it all pointed to Jesus. And so, geez, that's awesome stuff. Probably true, but it doesn't tell us why. Didn't tell the disciples why either. They were just there. Questions. Here's another one. They said to Jesus, we thought Elijah was supposed to come first. And if you read some of the Old Testament stuff, that's what it says. And Jesus says, well, actually that happened in John the Baptist. So he kind of explains this question, but you're still kind of left with, well, then why didn't the Old Testament, you know, you still got these questions. And then he says to his disciples, he says this to them. Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen. And a lot of us really wrestle with this. Well, isn't the gospel for the whole world? You know, we see this in Mark all the time. And it's in this plan of God. You know, we can explain it, but it's still a question, right? Until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. We get that, right? We get that. They didn't. This is what it says. They kept the matter to themselves, discussing that what rising from the dead meant. They didn't even get the rising from the dead stuff. They didn't know what the cross was about. They didn't know what the resurrection was about. All Peter knew was that he wanted a tabernacle with Jesus. He wanted that presence, that connection. He wanted to follow Jesus. He didn't understand much of anything at that point. You ever feel that way? You ever feel like as much as you knew, you didn't know anything anymore, for sure? Do you have questions? It's easy for me. I think about this stuff, you know, but I remember one night there was this elder in Denver. Oh, gosh, he was the most wonderful guy, the greatest elder. Loved people. When I had to take somebody down to the mission down on Denver, I could call him any time of the day or night. You go with me? Just a great guy, great grandfather. He had been a great father. Well, he went to the hospital, and I got called, and he had what's called an aortic aneurysm. Hours and hours he's in surgery. They kept trying to repair it, and they went all the way down to where it splits. I think it's called the vena cava or something, you know, all the way down to where it splits. Finally, he dies on the table like 6-8 hours. I don't get that. And I remember I'm driving home. It's Denver, right? So it'd been raining when I went, and now it's freezing. But I don't get it. I'm thinking about the family. I'm thinking about this guy. I'm saying, God, I don't get this one. Not that I have to get it, but I got questions here. He could have got a lot of good stuff. I don't get this one. And I get on the freeway. Did I tell you it was freezing? And there's freezing rain, and I hit the accelerator, and I'm bang, and hit the side of the freeway, and I'm looking the wrong direction. I got cars coming at me at 1 o'clock in the morning, and I'm thinking, I could die here. And when I turn that thing around, I think, why didn't I die? Why did he die, not me? Questions, huh? You ever have disappointments? I think sometimes with parents, it's when our children really suffer and struggle that we have the greatest questions in our lives. Amen? Yeah, amen. That's really tough. Or I remember my wife, Janie, she was this awesome teacher. And she got cancer, and the first thing they took away from her was teaching. And to this day, I don't get it, because she could have done so much good. You got questions? Why did that one get sick? Why do I have to go through this? What is this all about anyway? What are these shadows on my heart that I can't seem to get out from underneath of? Why is that guy in power that does such harm to people? I was talking to a young father this last week, and I asked questions when I'm thinking about this stuff, and I said, what question do you have that you really struggle with? And he said to me, just the uncertainty of life. I got young kids, you know, and the whole world seems to be in chaos, and I'm scared for them. And I don't know what to do about it. I talked to a young Christian gal, and she said, you know, I believe in Jesus, but my question is, what am I supposed to do with it? And how do I make a difference? And does it matter anyway? What questions do you especially struggle with? You see, that's the focus of this chapter. Jesus showed us the cross, shows us his power, his light. But the questions are still there. And they go on in this chapter. Go ahead. They come down the mountain. When they came to the other disciples, they saw a large crowd around them, and the teachers of the law. The teachers of the law arguing with them. Huh? And so go ahead. He says, what's going on? And a father comes up and says, teacher, I brought you my son who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. So I love this scene, right? I love this scene because it's kind of fleshing out the idea of we're going to live in questions. We're going to live in mystery. They come down the mountain. There's this big crowd there. They're arguing with the scribes, the Pharisees, and the father, and the crowd, and the disciples. They brought this son for them to cast out demons. They couldn't do it. Now think about that. Who gave them authority to cast out demons? Jesus did, right? In fact, he sent them out two by two, and they came back and they talked about it. And they said, man, it was cool. We cast out demons. So now they come down the mountain from the power that they saw in Jesus Christ, and they can't throw out this demon, man. That's the crowd, and they're fighting about it, huh? Why? Questions. Why don't the things that we work to achieve sometimes not work out, even in the kingdom? Jesus said, O unbelieving generation, how long will I be with you? And then bring the boy to me. He goes right to this place of faith. O unbelieving generation. What aren't they believing? I think what they're not believing is the presence of God in their midst. Bring the boy to me. And he talks to the father. And he says, and the father, you know, put that up real quick. Let's see what's there. The father said, he says to the father, what's going on? And he says, how long the boy has been this way? And he says, since childhood, and this demon throws him in the water and throws him in the fire, basically tries to kill him, right? He's doing these horrible things to him. And then the father says to him, if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. So you got this dialogue going, and it kind of fleshes out this unbelief, right? If you can do anything, Jesus says, if, what the heck are you talking about? If, don't you know who I am? Everything is possible for him who believes. Read the last line with me. 1, 2, 3. I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. There is no hope here. That's reality. To walk by faith in the midst of the questions, in the midst of mystery. Jesus, of course, he casts out the demon and heals this boy. But I have a question for you. This idea of faith, of belief, is about having a strong enough faith to simply receive what Jesus wanted to do? Or do you think he's pointing towards something else? Now, I thought about this. A lot of people say, well, you just have to have more faith. I think the guy had it right. I do believe, help my unbelief. Is your faith perfect? You got it all right? Everything's perfect right down the line? See, it puts us in a very dark place if we're always saying we have to have more faith if we want to see good things happen. I believe, help my unbelief. So here's my question. Is this about having enough faith in order to do something great? Or is it about having a faith that trusts the greatness and victory and heart of Jesus even in the midst of questions? Oh, unbelieving generation, what do they believe? That God was there, that God was alive, that God was active, that Jesus Christ was who he said he was, that he was bringing the kingdom. See, sometimes faith is the evidence of seeing things unseen, huh? That Jesus Christ, through his suffering and death on the cross, brings complete and total healing to everyone who trusts in him, now or in eternity, that he's going to restore and redeem all things, that everything is in his hands. Can you trust him? What kind of faith is he talking about here? That you got strong enough faith to do wonderful stuff? Or having this faith that trusts his grace and his victory and his heart? This compassionate heart that hurts for us even in the midst of questions. That's what this chapter is about. Shows us the glory and power of Jesus Christ. In the midst of questions, points us to this living faith. Not this staid idea that somehow I got faith stuck inside of me so God's got to like me. But no, a living, busy, vital, active relationship in Jesus Christ that says he's the King of kings and Lord of lords. I've seen his power. I've seen his cross. I trust him even in the midst of questions. This chapter goes on. Go ahead. The disciples are arguing on this as they walk this road of following Jesus. Who's the greatest? Wrong question. You don't ask that question if you're trusting in the Savior. If you're having faith that it's his glory and his power and his might, and in the midst of questions, you can trust him. You don't have to look to your own strength. You don't have to make yourself get more glorified and put others down, right? It's the wrong question. It's a question. Trying to answer the questions by making myself great instead of looking to the light of Jesus. Jesus says this, takes a child, whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me. What's he doing here? He's holding up a child. In another place it says you got to have faith like a child. Oh, unbelieving generation. Trust of a child. Children got to have a lot of questions, don't they? But if they know your heart, they trust you. That's the point here, see? There's this little parenthetical thing. It's so interesting to me how the writer, led by the Spirit, puts all this together. But it's a guy that's casting out demons that are not part of him. And they said, Master, Master, this guy's casting out demons. He's looking like he's greater than we are, you know? And he's casting out demons and he's not part of us. You want us to go tell? We'll tell him not to do that, huh? See, there's questions and there's mystery. He's not part of us. He's doing that stuff for the kingdom over there. Well, you know, he's not part of us. You think maybe Jesus can work in him? You think maybe Jesus can work over there? You think maybe Jesus can work across the street? You think maybe Jesus is alive and working in people before we ever connect with them? Can you trust that God is at work in this world through Jesus Christ? That even though it seems like everything is topsy-turvy, and at times it seems like evil is winning, and we can't understand things, and we have questions, and there's mystery, can you trust that even in those folks, Jesus Christ will work? Jesus says to them, hey, if they're not against us, they're for us. Leave them alone. I'm at work there too. You don't understand it. You got questions. That's all right. And then he goes right back to this theme with children. He says this, whoever causes one of these little ones who believes in me to sin. Now, it's, to me, this is interesting. A different word than children in the first one. It's little ones. You see what he's doing? He's talking about children and holding them up. And as I say, another place is the faith of a child. And now he's broadening out to all of God's little ones. To us. To walk as a child does. To trust Jesus. To remain in him. To just tabernacle with him. Not circled away from everything. But in the ongoing walk of life as we follow him. Chapter ends with this. Have salt in yourselves, this salt of knowing Jesus. This salt of knowing not only his cross, but his power. This salt of knowing that in the questions, in the unanswered questions, and in the mysteries, God has it all in his hands. And you can tabernacle with him, walk with him as he guides you. As his disciple, and be at peace, the shalom peace of relationship with God and relationship with all. Have Jesus in yourselves, and be at peace with each other. We see the cross, we know what it's all about. Disciples didn't. We see the Mount of Transfiguration, the power of Christ revealed. The disciples didn't know what it was all about. We see Easter, the empty tomb, the glory of Jesus. Yet he calls us to the same place, to tabernacle with him. To walk in that strong place that's called faith, even in the midst of questions, as we follow him. Life with Jesus. In the midst of the questions, there's the light and power of the Savior, this trusting reality of faith, and this peace as we rest in him. Would you pray with me? Dearest Jesus, sometimes in spite of ourselves, we are so prideful, we think all the questions have to be answered, and they have to be answered like we want them answered. Sometimes, Lord, we chafe at the mysteries that we have to live in. Lord, help us to just tabernacle with you and live from that place, because we know your cross, your glory, your empty tomb victory, and your heart. Help us to be disciples, to share these things, so that others might live with you as well. Pray in your name. Amen. We stand and we confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for a moment. We talk about the offering. Three ways to give here: online, with your phone, with a mobile phone, and also in person. I was thinking about this. One of the things I do is I read through the Bible every year, and I'm in the Old Testament, and there was this, God had everybody that was coming to the temple, everybody brought an offering. and I thought about that. Why? Because it's about relationship. You see, it was about trusting in the midst of questions, in the midst of how is God going to use this? What is he going to do with it? Why do I need to bring an offering? God has everything. And it's all about this relationship piece. There's a verse in Corinthians, and it talks about how whatever we do in the Lord is never done in vain. Somehow God will use our offerings to do great things, even as he uses them to bring us closer to himself in this tabernacle reality. Would you pray with me? Dearest Jesus, you would have us bring offerings. You have said where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So it's for us. But Lord, help us to trust that you will do great things, even when we maybe don't see it, even when we have questions. We pray that we might trust as we come together in this mission that you've given us, as we bring our offerings, knowing that you will do great things through us, even when we can't see it. We pray in your name. Amen. I'm sorry to do this to you, but let's stand for prayer, all right? We have a number of prayers today. You know, I'd like to pray open with what's happening in Ukraine. You know that our Inspire Hope MAT team, Ministry Action Team, made the decision. We tithe here at looking to take the hope of Jesus into our world. And our Ministry Action Team, they made a decision just about 10 days ago to give $10,000 to Samaritan's Purse that for their work with the Ukrainian refugees, and also $10,000 to a missionary in Hungary, to Sarah. And I got a phone call from Sarah, and she asked for prayer. She says, we're helping families, but she wanted prayer for this one family. They've been in social work, the Ukrainian, they've been in social work in the Ukraine, but also in gospel ministry, and they're trying to make it out, and things have gotten really tough just trying to get out of the war-torn country. So let's pray. Dearest Jesus, it's so easy, so easy to somehow live our lives thinking that these other things aren't real. But they're really not happening. That it's not about real people and real death and real suffering and real evil. Lord, we pray that you would use the offerings that we have given to help in this endeavor to help these refugees. We pray that you would use them powerfully through Samaritan's Purse and through the wisdom of Sarah, as she connects with other missionaries and other people on the ground there. We pray especially for this family, that in your will and you might bring them out and keep them safe, and they might continue to have a great witness in you. We pray for peace, Lord. We ask that you would move the leaders to make a peace for the sake of the people. And we pray that it might be a lasting peace. Hold back those who would kill and murder and destroy. And raise up those who would build and bring peace. Show us, Lord, how we can be a part of that. We pray in your name, and all God's people say, amen. We also pray for our sick. We pray especially for Tim, Rebecca, the Gershon family, and a friend of Marcia's. And we pray for the family of Anna, who was taken home to heaven, as well as all those who have been touched by death. We pray. Jesus, you are the Lord of life, the one who walked this earth and healed the sick and raised the dead. And so we come to you boldly, asking that you would move powerfully to help these who are struggling with illness and in other ways in their lives. And with this family and all families who are struggling as death has touched their life. Lord, we pray that you would show us and bring your spirit into the hearts of us and these people, Lord, that they might know that you are this compassionate, loving, awesome Savior who went the way of the cross but who won on Easter morning. Lord, we lay everything in your hands. We boldly ask that you would heal, and we boldly ask that your spirit would powerfully touch your hearts in the face of death with the victory of your resurrection. And Lord, show us how to be your hands and your voice in the lives of those who are hurting. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You may have noticed that Pastor Nathan is not here today. He's teaching the Foundations 2 class, Sharing Life. So we're going to pray for them. Lord, we have a lot of folks who are learning what it means to be a part of our mission and ministry together. We pray that your spirit would be passed with Pastor Nathan and in this group, that they might grow in knowing what we're about, and they might joyfully come to a place where they want to be part of it. We pray that that you would bring wisdom to this whole group and that you would guide them by your spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. As God's people, we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who at his transfiguration revealed his glory to his disciples, that they might be strengthened to proclaim his cross and resurrection, and with all the faithful look forward to the glory of life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you've had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in his name and the remembrance of Jesus, we humbly ask you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The peace of the Lord Jesus be with you always. Come, for all is now ready. Thanks be to God. You may be seated, and as the ushers release you, just come forward to receive Holy Communion.
Thank you.
Please stand. Now may this body broken and blood shed strengthen and preserve you in the true faith in this, this tabernacle reality with the Savior who makes his home within you every day and forever. We pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. We implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Just a couple of quick announcements. We have the congregational survey that you can take as you leave today. Also, we continue with our Wednesday night Lenten, lineup. We've got supper at 5:30. We had a good group this last week. Worship at 6:30, and also a group that Pastor Nathan is leading, a revisiting of the Red Letter Challenge. So that's all happening on Wednesday night together with our young people who are continuing their classes and the like. It's a happen in place on Wednesday, and love to have you be a part of that. Also, Fellowship Sunday, March 27th. It's a one-year anniversary of the opening of the cafe. You're invited to be a part of that, and you're invited to, I just had down here, you're invited to bring goodies. So, you know, the word koinonia that's translated fellowship, it actually means a sharing of. We share our lives. So if you want to be a part of that on the 27th, make sure you bring a lemon pie for Pastor, all right? So you're good. Receive now, no, I'm just kidding, receive now the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor, his grace, and give you his peace in Jesus. Amen. We close with verses 1, 3, and 6 of All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Great to be with you today. Have a wonderful week as you tabernacle with Jesus, as you walk this road of following him in his wondrous grace and power, greater than any questions that we may struggle with. May God be with you this week.